From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
The bios of all of the speakers are in your printed programs. We have asked the scholars when they take the stage to jump right into the conversation, so they will not be introducing themselves. However, they are all listed in the program with their bios, and they are listed in order of the conversations. Lastly, on behalf of everybody at the Kluge Center and on behalf of the Library of Congress, we really want to thank you for taking part of the celebration with us today. It wouldn't be a celebration without the scholars who have returned and all of you who are here. And we would love to have your feedback, both on this unique day and this unique format. We'd also love for you to stay connected to the Kluge Center in the future, and we do have a sign-up sheet on the way in and on the way out where you can leave us your email address to sign up to learn about future programs as well as opportunities to conduct your own research here in the Library of Congress. So, without further ado, let's begin, and I'd like to invite Jenna Weissman-Joslett and Georgia Michael to the stage.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to this scholastic version of speed dating. I'm Jenna Weissman-Joslett.
And I'm Georgia Michael.
And we're both very grateful to the Kluge Center for bringing us together to celebrate ideas and intellectual exchange. Georgia, you traffic in art. Mm-hmm. I traffic in vernacular culture, in stuff. You focus on the 4th, 5th, and 6th centuries. I'm ensconced in the late 19th and 20th centuries. Europe is the context for your work. The US is the context for mine. You zero in on Christians. I zero in largely on the Jews. What are we doing up here? What can we possibly say to one another other than how you're doing and hello? Or to put it more diplomatically, are there limits to interdisciplinarity? To put it even more politely still, what is it that we can learn from one another?
Yes, I think interdisciplinary sort of conversations are very useful, especially if we're looking at images from a methodological point of view, how we view images. How images are viewed in American culture in later centuries, and how we look at images more in the ancient world. So it would be interesting to see what type of methods that we would use, textual evidence or archaeological evidence or that type of thing.
Could you give a specific example?
I can give you a specific example of one illuminated manuscript in the 6th century where it's a Pentateuch, it's the five books of the Bible, the first books, where we have visual images there of God.
What does he look like?
What does he look like? Well, it's the first folio where it's the creation, and there are two creators plus the Holy Spirit. And what's interesting about this particular folio, somebody two centuries later went and painted over the pair of God, if you like. And he's got long hair, and he's got a beard, and this is how they visualized him. So, therefore for me, it would be looking at what is going on in this period. Why are they making this image? You know, the historical, political, ideological context I'm interested in. Why this manuscript comes about and the function. So therefore, I would like to sort of know in American culture how these images that possibly you work with are, how do you sort of look at that methodologically?
The same way you do.
It's the same.
Same way you do. I think that what we in the 20th century also have to our advantage is the built environment. So very often the things that I'm looking at are ensconced in a building, and I could actually get up on a ladder and look at a stained glass window really closely, or look at a monument that's planted in a civic square, and be able to take the measure of it quite directly instead of having to rely on all sorts of mediated sources.
Right, right, okay.
Mm-hmm. You know, as it happens, I'm making my way right now through a book that explores anti-Jewish iconography in early medieval and medieval Europe, and it's not so much the specifics of the information that is absolutely riveting, but the way the author, who's a woman by the name of Sarah Lipton, thinks.
Yes.
The book just came out, so you might want to take a look.
Mm-hmm.
And what she does is to look historically at the notion of seeing, at visuality, and how the purposes of visuality change over time, depending not so much on theology, but a lot more on the nature of artistic production, the social and cultural context. Mm. And so I find it really wonderful and stretching for me as a historian of modern America to be able to take my interpretive cues from a book that is situated so squarely within the medieval period. And hopefully you'll be able, in the fullness of time, whenever I finish this damn book, that you'll be able to take from it a certain interpretive stance or a series of questions. Again, not so much information, but a way of thinking about visuality that would enlarge the interpretive parameters of your own work.
Yes. You mentioned it, this lady that
Sarah Lipton. I'll write it down for you later.
She's looking at visual culture. So this is a different way of a method. This is another method of looking at visuality. Is that what we're saying here, or?
I don't know that she's inventing a new methodology so much as asking a different set of questions of the material.
Okay.
And taking her cue very much internally from the material and then refracting it through a very smart postmodern interpretive lens that has to do with sensation, cognition, seeing. And so it's very generative. Again, it's not on point necessarily with my work, but it just promised me to ask a series of questions about the Ten Commandments and how they make themselves felt, the presence of the Ten Commandments in modern America.
I mean, for me, I'm sort of more focused on looking at what the images meant for the viewer in the centuries I work with.
And so how do you get at that, since so much of your material is mute, isn't it?
I'll give you an example. When I went to Rome in September, I went down in a very dark catacomb, 60 feet below the ground, and I found a burial place where there was images that showed me visually that they knew the difference between idolatrous art and non-idolatrous art, where true worship goes and where we should not have worship. And these images were juxtaposed. So,
what were the images of?
The one image was on the right-hand side. It was the three wise men taking the gifts towards Jesus and the Virgin Mary. So, worship towards the true God, the Christian God. Juxtaposed on the other side, going away from the tomb, there was the three Hebrew youths, where they rejected Nebuchadnezzar's request to bow down before an idol, and there was a Roman, Nebuchadnezzar took the image of the emperor, the Roman emperor, so he looked like a Roman emperor with a an idol, and the three Hebrew youths are sort of got their hands up like this, rejecting idolatry. So it was this visual juxtaposition of we worship the true God, but we reject idols.
So is that a discovery of yours? Had nobody else been down in the catacombs?
It wasn't a specific. I knew about the images. I really wanted to go and see how the. I just had photos of the images, but I wanted to see how they were worked in space, in the space of the tomb.
Right.
And it was interesting to see how the worship was going towards the tomb, but the rejection of worship was going away from the
So there's something very exciting and expanding, isn't it, when you actually get your hands dirty and your legs
yes.
dirty. So you were down in the tomb.
Yes.
The other day, I was up on a rickety ladder, I don't know how feet tall, trying to make out a stained glass window that had purportedly been about the Ten Commandments, and the representational aspects of this window mm-hmm. Have vanished, but the frame of the window is still intact. So I thought if I get really high up on a ladder yeah. and use a telephoto lens, I'll be able to see, perhaps, but...
You couldn't.
I nearly fell off the ladder.
Oh, we don't want that to happen.
But that's a good story.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a good story. Okay. So one of the things that strikes me in both our work, despite the great disparity, geographical
yes.
and conceptual, is the ways in which contemporary terms, very 21st century mm-hmm. terms about recycling, repurposing, are brought to bear on antiquity. And I think that is what makes our work that relates to religious symbols and the afterlife of religion so compelling. So do you find that too? Do you find that there's something really exciting about trying to position your work within the context of modern America and modern Britain?
I think that's a difficult question to really say. I mean, the images I deal with that are sort of looked, they're more, I don't want to say Britain, I want to say Greece, because these images are really controversial within the Greek Orthodox Church. And so not necessarily the context of Britain, okay. but in the context of Greece. Okay.
So we're getting the high sign. We'll leave you with that cliffhanger.
Yeah.
And thank you very much.
Good morning. So I thought Marie and I could continue a conversation that we started earlier before the event took place. So Marie, a line has separated academic history from so-called popular history. And I wanted to ask you how you feel about this. Is this distinction real or imagined? What do academic historians need to do in order to reach wider audiences? What is the role of popular historians in our cultural and intellectual life?
I think that would take a whole career to answer, but I'll try in a few minutes. Good morning, everybody. And this is wonderful because although Alex and I were here in 2009, 2010 as Kluge people together, this is our first conversation, so this is really wonderful. It's a really interesting question, and it's an ongoing sort of argument. I've seen this question from three sides, from the side of book publishing in my early career, moving on to be a literary critic and the running a magazine of criticism at the Washington Post, The Review, and then being an author myself of history. And I've had the conversation in depth with Gordon Wood, who is a very good friend of mine, and he laments the fact that academic historians are not more widely read. And so do I. The fine line between popular history, I think, and academic history has everything to do with writing and tone and the whole business about creating a narrative line. And I think that there have been wonderful academic historians who have done this so well, James McPherson and Gordon Wood himself, and Gary Gallagher, who has been wonderful. Richard Overy, I think of as well. The people who, academicians, who actually can tell a story and tell it in sort of bright, colorful, and different ways with accumulated insight. Margaret Macmillan, too, who is on our Scholars Council, is a wonderful writer in that way. And then there's the popular side, the public intellectuals, the people who have come predominantly from journalism, people who, like me, have been steeped in books, steeped in writing, steeped in the whole business of storytelling. And those people who have gone on to do great work in history, really, and people like David McCullough and Max Hastings, who's a marvelous military historian, Rick Atkinson, who is also a marvelous military historian. I'm also thinking of Anthony Beaver, British popular historians. You can't really call them popular. So the line, Alex, you're right. It's a very fuzzy line because they're well researched, they're well documented, they're extraordinarily sturdy. Academic. So all of it has to do, I think, with this, and it particularly happens in the American Academy, I think, in history, is the tendency to not want to tell the big story, not want to tell the tell it in a narrative, sort of compelling way. And those of us who write, shall we say, popular history, are very dependent on the monographs of historians who actually do the work. But, you know, I want to talk about you because we share, apart from being sort of struggling across the public intellectual and academic divide, I really admire the work that you've done, Alex. When we think of the South American conquest, which is it has been an obsession of ours for a long time. It has been my subject and the whole question of race. And when we think of the conquest, we think of first contact, we think of culture shock, we think of the imposition of race hierarchy, we think of the search for gold and silver and the colonial exploitation and the emergence, really, of a new world, a totally new world, born of conflict and born of shock. But we seldom think of that historic moment as a kind of question of space, of elbow room, and of geography. And you've done that. Did Indigenous America and old Europe see land and geography in different ways?
Yes and no. So I want to quickly approach this question in two ways. I think at the macro level, what we might now call in a nation state vision, empires were plotting space and were thinking about land and were thinking about geography, but they were thinking about it fairly subjectively in a kind of broad idea of conquest and domination, of expansion of economic trade, and you see this plotted on both European maps, but also maps that were developed in the Americas prior to the arrival of Spaniards. The more interesting question for me is how it plays out at the local and the regional level, because this is where you really get a chance to see how different groups of people, indigenous people, Africans, Europeans and also mixed race people are engaging each other and are really struggling for that elbow room and to divide space. And so while Spaniards, for the most part, effectively control urban areas, they really are not effective at controlling the rural areas. They're much more dominated by indigenous people. They develop in urban cities the so-called grid pattern, the traza, to try to very orderly divide how they see their cities and how they see the way that space should play out. But it's an imagined division. And so we do see it in cities and we see that urban development. But in reality, it does not help to separate Spaniards from Indians, et cetera. And then in another respect, I think about space and I think about geographic knowledge. I think about the way that boundaries, that reservoirs, the way that plants and mountains affect colonization. And these are all items that are controlled by indigenous people. So despite the fact that, say, for example, the Spaniards launch a imperial survey to try to measure geography in plants, they rely heavily on the knowledge of Indians in order to try to assimilate and to account for what's happening there. And so we see this very much tied in the maps that indigenous people produce. Mary, you want to?
I was going to just ask you, I would imagine that language has something to do with it too, the way that language characterizes space and geography.
Absolutely, and I think that a very interesting aspect to think about that is that while Spaniards come in and rename cities, usually either after saints or some sort of Catholic deities, they also remain spaces, towns, cities, villas, etc., retain the indigenous name as well. And if we think about how that plays out historically, we wind up knowing a lot of these places not by the European imposed name, but rather by the indigenous name. Mm-hmm. I think we still have a couple of minutes, and I wanted to bring it back to one of your works, an award-winning book that you wrote on Simón Bolívar. So how do you make this revolutionary figure relevant to 21st century audiences? What is it about Latin America, this revolutionary period, that attracts you to this turbulent epoch?
Well, it's really interesting, that question, because I didn't have to make him come alive. I mean, you walk through the urban spaces of Latin America and you see murals and graffiti saying, La revolución anda, sigue, you know, the revolution is still happening. You see images of Bolívar. You see, it's in many, many ways, the South American revolution is not over. There were a lot of things that were fought for and claimed at the point of independence that were simply not won. I think the inequality that Bolívar railed against, and the injustices, the hope that enlightenment would come to this very blinded, you know, benighted land, actually was very slow to happen. The moment that independence took place, whites simply used took over the power that the Spaniards had. And so there began a kind of mercurial afterlife of Bolívar, because the revolution had never been won, and there was so much yet to do. And I think that this is why he's still very much alive. It was a lot of fun to write about him, because all the questions that he asked were still very much alive today. I have time for a tiny question. No more.
All right.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So, Kate, you and I were here at the Library of Congress in the Kluge Center in 2004 and 5, working on research having to do with topics in the Civil War era. I remember you giving a splendid lecture on contraband, a new term for me in the historical context, speaking of slaves who came over into the Union lines and posed both an opportunity and a challenge to the Union occupying forces. Can you explain a little bit more how that project led on to your later work, and then maybe also the kind of moral or ethical questions that that line of research has raised for you?
Sure, that's a small question to get us started. Thank you, and thank you for being here. So when I was here at the Library of Congress, I was a postdoc, and I always say that I felt a little bit guilty, because I was supposed to be quickly turning my dissertation into a book, but I really wanted to work on a project that was incredibly well-suited to the Library of Congress's collections, which had to do with popular culture and print sources from the Civil War era. And there's probably nowhere better in the entire world to work on something like that than here. And so I just plunged into that. I figured my book would happen, and I was going to write this article that was related to my research in my book, but was a little bit different. And it was about the phenomenon of slaves during the course of the American Civil War escaping from slavery and coming to find freedom and shelter and safety amidst the United States Army, which was kind of on the periphery of the Confederacy at the beginning of the war, and then increasingly moved into occupying the Confederacy. And during the course of my time here, I basically wrote that article. It ended up being published in the Journal of American History, and then I did write my book, and so everything turned out okay. But when I think about that article in the larger trajectory of what I've been interested in during my career and what I continue to be interested in, it has to do with how Americans came to grips with slavery and the end of slavery, and what kind of a nation was possible to create given the historical context and the existence of slavery as, you know, perhaps the most important institution in the economic and political life of this country from the beginning. And so the article about contrabands was really an article about representations of contrabands. There are lots of people, and increasingly now, who are writing about the social history of the end of slavery during the American Civil War. What was literally happening on the ground? My article was a kind of about how Northerners primarily represented contraband, people escaping slavery in popular culture, in things like popular songs, in cartoons, in fiction, in poetry. And what really preoccupies me is, again, how do people come to terms with the question of what would be the citizenship status of former slaves? What rights would former slaves have? To what extent would the nation as a whole attempt to re-envision a nation in which racial equality was a possibility? And if it were to happen, what kinds of equality were on the table? What kinds of equality were not on the table? And that was a theme of my book, which is about the history of Reconstruction in Washington, D.C. And now I'm working on that same question, but for the antebellum period leading into the Civil War. So as I thought about what we were going to talk about today, what came to mind was sort of some of the motifs in my scholarship over the last 10 years since I was here. So with that, I'll just turn it back to you, Mark. What would you say, you know, you were working on the Civil War as a theological crisis, terrific, concise book about the problem of the relationship between slavery and national destiny and the coming of the Civil War. And I'm wondering, sort of what you did after that and how that work informed what you've done since then.
Well, it was a great privilege to be here as the McGuire Chair of American History and Ethics, and really a great privilege today to thank Mr. McGuire for the gift that made the chair possible. I was particularly interested in what you were doing on Northern reactions to the escaped enslaved people, because my project was on how religious beliefs and practices were being put to use for arguments about the justification for or against slavery. You felt a little bit nervous about not rushing to finish your book. I brought in 7 or 8 file boxes of papers that were going to lead me to have a complete study of the public history of the Bible from Christopher Columbus to, at the time, George W. Bush. And I ended up with a book on about 4 years in American history. But at the heart of the book was the Northern use of religious arguments on slavery, not Southern use. What was particularly impressive to me was to find out how strong the pro-slavery argument from the Bible was in the North. Work at the Library of Congress was especially important because the library has resources from all over the world, particularly the Western world, and I was able to find material from France, from Germany, from Austria, from French Canada and English Canada that looked at the United States and said, how could anyone use the Bible to defend slavery in the middle of the 19th century? The answer was in the history that had led up to that particular use of scripture, which actually then draws on the broader question of how, as historians, we try to get inside the minds of people who are upholding positions that we find abhorrent. And I know anyone who works on any aspect of the United States history with respect to minority people, with Native Americans, or with African Americans, or sometimes with Asian Americans, has to deal with this problem of trying to be a historian working with materials that we find personally very troubling. How do you handle it?
Well, it's such an interesting question. I was thinking about this. It brought to mind a conversation I had actually with the chair of my department when I was an assistant professor on the, you know, kind of hoping to get tenure someday. And she had read a draft of my book manuscript, and she said, and this is about Reconstruction in Washington, it's about this great democratic political movement by former slaves, by African Americans, to expand voting rights to all men. There was a movement at that time for women's voting rights. It was a moment of great democratic possibility. But I was also writing about the people who wanted to shut that down. And in Washington, they were mostly businessmen, real estate developers who didn't much care about democracy or no democracy. They just wanted to develop the city. And the chair of my department said, you know, this is going to be a good book, but those developers, those kind of people who wanted to shut down this democratic moment, they come across really flat. And you have to try to understand them better, and you have to get into their minds better and tell us what was motivating them. And her advice was really important to me, and it made me realize that the history that I was writing would be so much better if I really tried to put myself in the shoes of the people that I really did not have a lot of respect for, who I didn't think were looking at the big picture, who I didn't think were trying to uphold values that I care about, and really try to understand what made them want to do what they were doing. And so I've tried to carry that lesson forward in my current work, which has to do with the conflict between ideas about liberty and ideas about policing. From the earliest days of the American nation until the Civil War. And the people on the side of more policing, more restrictions on liberty, these are the people that I feel especially compelled to understand. And so I'm curious, yeah. You know, as a historian of religion, and I've always thought, and I personally have enormous respect for people who study religion and feel like it would be so daunting because there are so many moral and ethical issues built directly into that. And so, and you've written so compellingly about pro-slavery Christianity. I wonder, you know, how you have dealt with that same question.
Yes, indeed, and it faces the issue of what's the vocation to which a historian is called. And certainly, historians are people with moral opinions and want to make moral judgments, but I think the vocation of a historian is to explain first before judging. And in the case of my research, I'm working with people for whom the scriptures were vital for the construction of a civilization. After the American Revolution, the United States needs to build a civilization from the ground up. There is no inherited nobility. There's no tradition. There is voluntary self-starting action, and in that voluntary self-starting action, Protestant reliance on the Bible was critical. So what was good coming out of early American history also made then the problem of using the scriptures to defend slavery. So I felt that while not approving that use, I could understand how it was built into the fabric of early American life. And I think we've been given the signal to end our conversation. Great. Kate, thanks very much.
Thank you.
Hello, and good morning, and thanks very much for coming, and thank you for inviting me. My name is Will Hitchcock. This is Renata Keller. And we're going to ask and address a rather small question. Does the Cold War matter anymore? We are both Cold War historians, but we come at the subject from very different fields. I've worked on Europe and the United States, and Renata has worked on Latin America and the Caribbean. So we'll have different views on that question, and we come at it from different generations. So that will be interesting to explore a little bit as well. Many of you were present last night at a wonderful event. We had two leading public intellectuals, historians, public servants, who spoke in the most extraordinarily moving and interesting and thoughtful terms about their lives in the 20th century. Their lives had been led in Brazil and in India and, of course, on the public stage. But in those two countries, as they described it, the issues that framed the 20th century course of their nation's history had to do with race, decolonization and colonialism, slavery, nationalisms, globalization, ethnic, sectarian, religious conflict, as well as cooperation, economic development, especially economic economic development. It was a wonderful tour de force. Two wonderfully interesting, thoughtful people. Neither of them mentioned the Cold War. My point is not to say that they should have. The Cold War didn't particularly have much bearing on what they wanted to say. But to me as a historian, and especially as a teacher now of students who are in their 20s and teens and who have no personal memory of the Cold War is starting, in my view, I think, to shrink a little bit. When I started working on the Cold War, wow, it was exciting. It was the early 90s, Cold War had just ended, the new sources were coming out of the archives, Eastern Europe and Russia were opening up, and we had a sense that in studying the Cold War as graduate students, we were explaining the origins of our own time. Now, my students who are so interested in global history and the way the world works don't necessarily see the Cold War as having the same explanatory power that my generation saw it as having. So I thought we would just kind of get into this question. Does the Cold War matter? I mean, obviously the answer is, we're going to say, is probably yes, but I don't want to assume. But how? Why? What can we extract from this period in world history that still resonates today? And I wonder if you've thought about this and what your views are.
I think especially it depends on the local context, but I would argue that especially for Latin America, the Cold War does still matter. In places where the Cold War wasn't really very cold at all, a lot of these people lived through it. They lost family members, even people in power today, President Rousseff of Brazil, the presidents of Nicaragua and Guatemala, were people who fought the Cold War themselves. And so that clearly had to shape the way that they see the world. I think it also matters because now we're fighting two wars that are very similar to the Cold War, the war on terror, the war on drugs. And I think a lot of the ways people approach these conflicts are informed by the way that the Cold War played out. And I think, so a lot of these same questions, a lot of the same tactics and approaches very much mirror the Cold War, and I think by understanding the Cold War better, it can help maybe improve the way that we approach our current conflicts and our current challenges. But maybe that's just Latin America. I'd be curious to know what you think, whether the same things apply to Europe or the U.S.
I certainly do, but I want, before we leave Latin America, do you think that Latin American historians would agree with that? That is to say, in studying Latin America and the Caribbean, does the Cold War still loom as large as maybe it might have when we were still working with fewer sources or more Western and more Northern sources? What's changed in the field that might make the Cold War more interesting, more provocative, or reveal some more surprises than we might have seen before? I know you've been peeling back the layers using new sources, which is really having the opportunity to reimagine the field as we might have thought of it 25 years ago.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and Cold War scholars in Latin America are also very excited about these sources, and it's still also very controversial. So in Mexico, the sources I used were mostly this intelligence archive that this year they just closed it, and people in Mexico have been organizing and really advocating for this is, you know, part of their national patrimony. People need to know what happened in Mexico. They need to know that there was a dirty war there in the 60s and 70s. And so just last week, there was enough movement on the part of Mexican civil society, Mexican intellectuals, and now they're deciding to reopen this archive. And so it's extremely important for people working there as well.
And yet, if we chatted in the dinner line last night, and I learned that you're writing a history of the Cuban Missile Crisis, which in a way is the classic Cold War story. So, but you're asking some new questions and using some new sources to get at this, which is exactly what the next generation should be doing. Mm-hmm. Can you just say one word about it? Because it sounds so interesting.
Oh, sure. So my next project is a hemispheric history of the Cuban Missile Crisis, because, you know, these missiles were in Cuba, and while, you know, we always read about this, you know, conflict between Kennedy and Castro. Well, Kennedy wasn't Castro's only enemy in the hemisphere, and those missiles could have reached really anywhere in Latin America. So this wasn't just a threat for the U.S. It wasn't just an issue for the Soviet Union and Cuba. It really was a global question, and it brought up all of these other questions about, you know, who's allowed to defend themselves and how, and what does this mean for people who are, you know, within the scope of the Americas? You know, who do you align with? And it really, there was a much more visceral reaction across Latin America than we ever hear about or read about.
For me, the Cold War still, and for my students, and I try to encourage them to think about it this way, it's still a wonderful place to test various theories about international order. So, do nuclear weapons make the world safer or more dangerous? That's a classic question that Cold War historians have been debating, which we're still dealing with today. Are alliances valuable in settling, bringing the world together, or actually are they at times provocative? These sorts of theoretical questions can constantly be tested by using reference to the Cold War. Another thing that I think is really important for young people in my classrooms to understand is that ideology is something that we live and breathe. Americans, especially American young people, don't think they're ideologues. They don't understand what that word means. But if we look at the Cold War, we find ideology dramatically shaped, one might even say warped, the behavior of not only Americans, but many others around the world. So what is ideology? The Cold War can help us understand that term and reveal it and watch it in action so that we can then reflect on our own actions. Mm-hmm. In the early 21st century, are Americans ideological? Do we behave ideologically? What are our ideological assumptions? That's often a very challenging concept for young people to sort of grapple with. And then I think, and this is, comes back to something you said, one of the things that the Cold War reminds us and what new scholars are showing us more and more is that the global is always local. While we sometimes, those of oldsters like us focus on sort of statesmen, often now are confronted with the fact that the actions of diplomats and statesmen have a dramatic effect on the lived experience of millions of people around the world. And that is something we have to recapture and do a better job of working on. And we can only do it through multilingual, multi-archival research. And that's why I'm very excited about what you're doing.
Oh, thanks. And I think it also works the other way around too, right? That all of these local issues are what shape the decision-making process of national leaders and international leaders, that they can never ignore what's going on at home when they're making these decisions about international relations or nuclear warfare. And so I think that's what's so interesting about the Cold War is it has all these different layers, both within countries and across countries, and then across this very wide time span. So you can explore all of these different questions that you've been talking about.
Oh, rats. Running out of time. But just really quickly, are there any, I don't want to put you on the spot, but I'm going to. Are there any great books that you go back to and say, golly, I wish I'd written that one. I admire that book. Or that's the kind of work I want to write. And I'll just say, while you're thinking. So in Cold War history, Odd Arne Westad has written a great book on the global Cold War, which is quite remarkable, which I admire a lot. My colleague Mel Leffler is here, and he's going to speak later today. He's written a great book on ideology and how it influenced American leaders. Any things that are people in your generation are working on, or older books that you say, that's still a pretty good book?
That's a good question.
We didn't prepare this one.
I know. I'm on the spot. One of my favorite historians of Latin America in general is Piero Gliese's, and I really admire the depth he has in the way he's able to get into new archives, and not just archives, but also interview people and get to know all of the people involved. And he's written some fantastic books about Guatemala, the revolution there, about Cuban involvement in Africa's decolonialization process. So I would say that one.
Great choice. Yeah. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Devika Singh.
I'm Roger Lewis.
Roger Lewis. Roger, I've heard that part of your work at the Kluge concerned Churchill. And I was thinking if we could start maybe by you telling us more about Churchill's relation to the British Empire.
Okay, I'll begin with just a word of gratitude for the Kluge Center giving people the opportunity to come here and to work and to meet other people. I have a certain perspective on this, for better or worse. I was involved with Jim Billington and Pross Gifford way back when the Wilson Center was created, and rather followed them here to the creation of the Kluge Center with Pross Gifford as the deputy, as the first director of the Kluge Center. And it was at that time that I began to be aware of the potential of the Kluge Center and the Library of Congress. The Kluge Center is the sponsor, along with the National History Center of the American Historical Association, of an annual seminar on decolonization, which brings 15 young historians every year at about the level of the completion of the PhD dissertation to do research and study the dissolution of the European colonial empires. This has been going on now for 9 years, and this will be our 10th year at the Library of Congress, and at the end of July, there will be some 150 young historians who have studied the dissolution of the European colonial empires. I thought I would say a word just about Churchill simply because it's a matter of public interest, the way in which the controversies continue to evolve. Churchill, especially in this country, is recognized as the great savior of the West during the Second World War, indeed of Western civilization, which he is. And yet there are certain things about him that are controversial. For example, on the questions of India, Churchill was a reactionary. He believed that India should be held as a permanent part of the British Empire, but he had various different views about other parts of the empire. Could we turn to you and ask you about your work at the Kluge Center?
Oh, thank you. My work at the Kluge Center concerns an art review that is called MARG, that was the leading art review in India from the 1940s to the 1960s. And what's absolutely fascinating about MARG is that it showed side-by-side articles on Indian artists of the time, but also on Western art and architecture. So it was a great channel for the appropriation and the circulation and the fusion of modernism in India, and it also included articles on past historical legacies of India. And this research led to an article in Modern Asian Studies.
Tell us more.
I can tell you what I'm doing now and what really also comes from this research at the Kluge, so I'm also extremely thankful for my time here. Now I'm writing a book on artistic creation in post-independence India, so drawing from this research on MARG, and this is really about breaking with what has long been a Western-centered view of art history. It's about locating, in my case, Indian art within a broader global or transnational history of modernism. And the way I do that is by looking at the works of Indian artists, but also foreign artists who were active in India after independence. I look at instances of exchanges and appropriations, but also at instances of misunderstandings and even sometimes rejections that resulted from this encounter. Now, returning to you, because we did prepare that, you wanted me to ask you about Churchill's role in setting up the new state of Iraq. And I was curious to find out how he did do that.
Well, I thought this, again, would be just a matter of general interest. Churchill became the colonial secretary in 1921, and so it fell to Churchill to organize the first administration in what we now know as the state of Iraq. He had a single purpose, and that was to keep the expense minimal and to achieve only a minimal administration. And he was helped in this goal by being able to recruit T.E. Lawrence. This is T.E. Lawrence of Arabia. They had met at the Paris Peace Conference in 1919. They liked each other. T.E. Lawrence was a very good listener. Churchill said that his eyes beamed, glistened when he listened to what Churchill had to say. They both wanted this minimal goal in Iraq, but for slightly different reasons. Lawrence, of course, has the reputation, the myth of the great champion of Arab nationalism, the great champion of a downtrodden nation. Lawrence supporting the Arabs, but being double-crossed by his own country and having to retreat from the idea of an independent Arab nation. Well, in fact, if you look at the actual records of T.E. Lawrence as a military intelligence officer, things become much more comprehensible. Lawrence did believe that the Arab nation of Iraq should become independent, but he also believed that it needed to become, that the British needed to achieve military victory as soon as possible to be able to acquire control over the oil reserves. And so Lawrence said it's much regrettable, this is in his private correspondence to Churchill and so on, that we had to deceive King Faisal, Prince Faisal, who had helped lead the Arabs to victory, but it was necessary for us to be able to obtain control over the Iraqi oil. And so Lawrence wanted a minimal administration and to put Faisal in control of Iraq, but the wording, the secret minutes and so on are quite explicit about this. They're saying, in effect, that we want to install him as a puppet and we can pull the strings. And this was, in fact, what happened. They established Faisal as the king of the rock with minimal economic resources. In fact, Churchill decided that it was not the British Army but the Royal Air Force that would keep order, because with this would mean a lessening of the expense. It would save a lot of money by transferring control to the Royal Air Force, and the Royal Air Force, if necessary, would use poison gas against rebellious tribes. So those were the techniques that the British used to establish control over Iraq. Iraq achieved independence 10 years later, and the aim was exactly the same, to achieve minimal expense and to let the Iraqis eventually rule their own state, but with the British still pulling the strings. If you could tell us a little more about your work in modern art and criticism.
Yes, thank you. Well, the first thing I should say to return to Indian modern art is that it's a new field, and it was set up by leading art historians such as Partha Mitter. But for the post-independence period, so after 1947, it really hasn't been looked into with the same amount of scrutiny. And I find this very exciting. So for example, when I was at the Kluge, I was looking not only at this art journal Mark, I also started to look at the role that Jewish Austrian exile played in the post-independence Bombay art world. These were Jewish exiles who came, of course, before the Second World War, but who stayed in India after the war and played a very important role in promoting Indian art. I spoke earlier about how to locate Indian art in a more transnational context. So this is about, really, my work is about acknowledging the multiple set of actors with whom Indian artists interacted. And here, as I mentioned, art reviews are important, but also fellowships abroad and exhibitions. And I'll give you the example of an exhibition called the Triennial India, which was set up in Delhi in the late 1960s, and which brought together with Indian art the art of Japan, of Czech artists, of Russian artists, and many others. So this was a truly global event that happened in Delhi and invites us to consider modernism as truly multi-centered. And in the case of the United States, there was a fantastic exhibition that was sent by New York's Museum of Modern Art in the late 1960s too, and that was accompanied by Clement Greenberg, and that included the works of Jackson Pollock, Cy Twombly, Robert Rauschenberg. It's a sort of exhibition that would never happen today. And at the same time, Indian artists were going to the United States on fellowships abroad. But what's the salient point, the last point I make, is that Indian artists, far from being in a relationship of subservience or of derivativeness, exercised a great deal of agency in discerning between influences, adopting some while rejecting other, and creating an output that was truly original.
Oh. Patricia Sullivan, it's good to see you again.
Always good to see you, Maurice Jackson.
You know, the great Du Bois once said that the battle we wage is not for ourselves alone, but it's for all true Americans. William Walling, the American, the Kentucky socialist, says that the Negro's only hope is at the same time the sole safeguard of the nation. And they said this both in the founding of the NAACP. In essence, they meant that the role of this organization was not just for blacks, but for the preservation of beginning of rights for blacks and the preservation of rights for the nation as a whole. What do you think?
Yeah, well, that was one of the fascinating aspects of studying the history of the NAACP from its founding period. You know, sort of the early 20th century version of Black Lives Matter and why. I mean, Walling made that statement in the aftermath of a race riot in Springfield, Illinois, home of Abraham Lincoln, which sent shockwaves, through progressive circles in the North, fearing that, I mean, that riot was sparked by the attempt of a mob to really lynch two black men who had been arrested on charge of rape, one on murder. And when their efforts were turned back, they attacked the black community in Springfield, rioted for 2 days, killed 8 black men, and caused 2,000 people to flee the city. And that's the origins of the founding of the NAACP, this fear of the Southern practices spreading to the North. And at that moment in the early 20th century, you know, we think of historians of race and American history of the imposition of a caste system, a legal caste system in the South during that early period. But what's also happening is as blacks migrate to the North, the reaction to the black presence and the creation of an enforcement of segregation and really the use of violence, which is something we've talked about, to enforce kind of a racial order. So you have that going forward, a movement in the South that's attacking the legal structures, and in the North, this effort that really is largely unsuccessful to push back against the kinds of racism and segregation that's growing up during this period. And that sort of speaks to your current project, though I'd like to go back and talk a little bit about Anthony Benezé. When we met here, when I was working on the NAACP, you were working on your book about that remarkable, really the leading abolitionist of the 18th century, involved with Quaker sort of nonviolence and really attacking the whole intellectual and philosophical structure of slavery. And now you're currently working on a book on Washington, D.C., and looking at violence in the creation of Washington, D.C. Could you elaborate on that a bit in terms of these issues?
Well, thank you. You know, when I came to the Kluge, I was looking at Benezé, and Anthony Benezé was a French-born Quaker, 1784. And one reason was that I grew up in the South. I had never seen what you say is a good white person. And so as I went, I saw Benezé, and I saw a man who did everything for the salvation of blacks. And in 1762, he wrote something called Some Historical Accounts of Guinea. And in that, he asked the question, what should be done with the Negro? Mm-hmm. As I started reading the book on Washington, working on the book on Washington, I came across a quote from Frederick Douglass at Cooper Union Hall a few days before slaves were emancipated in Washington, D.C., April 16th, 1862, exactly 100 years after Benezé. He said the question, what should be done with the Negroes once emancipated? I look on and then I come 50 years later, Du Bois, and so is the black folks, ask the same question. What should be done with the Negroes? Shall he be brought into the Union of Nations or shall he be thrown out with the wolves? And so this created a large range of questions for me. And the big question was how white America responds to blacks as they fight for democracy. Mm-hmm. In Washington, we saw many examples. 1835, there was a revolt. But it was led by whites. And most times when people think about riots, they think about blacks. But in 1835, it was whites who rioted because a man named Arthur Bowen had allegedly hit a woman named Anna Thornton, who he lived with, and she was the wife of the former architect of the Capitol. But he didn't. It was all a ruse. But there was a riot, and mainly about whites at the Navy Yard. Mm-hmm. Now, go up to 1919, and there's a riot in Washington, D.C., at this exact same place, the Navy Yards, and they are by demobilized white soldiers, many walking around in mustard in suits, not the uniforms, mm-hmm. But also many who were resentful. And they became resentful because they thought that blacks were here to usurp their rights and their jobs. And blacks had fought heroically, like James Reese Europe, the great musician in Europe. Mm-hmm. So as I look at that, I look at that violence perpetuated against blacks here in Washington, D.C., and often it's said that this was the first time in Washington in 1919 that blacks had fought back. Mm-hmm. And it's an incorrect assumption. Blacks had fought back. They just hadn't fought back with weapons. In 1919, they fought back with weapons. But both incidences, and including another incident in 1848 when the ship Pearl, blacks got the ship Pearl and tried to escape to Philadelphia. And I don't know if any of you remember a play, Day of Absence, by Douglas Turner Ward. As they say, Safeway, all the blacks were gone. And so these are many examples of when the whites captured the blacks, they put them in chains and sent them down south. So every time blacks have sought freedom, they've been violenced, in these cases, by white Americans. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Right. But what has been, but you wrote about Benezé and thinking about the role of whites in this struggle, or the moments in history when whites have a capacity even to see it. I mean, to see the contradictions and challenge the structures.
Well, personally, I think whites have not lived up to it, mm-hmm. and that is the big question. And so that is the big question that I think you are going to today. The role that the whites played in the formation of the NAACP, mm-hmm. but also the role of whites in the preserving of rights that also are there. Let me give an example. In class, I often say to students, name me one thing that has ever been done to aid a black person that hadn't helped a white person just as much. And they were hem and haw, and then they say affirmative action. And I tell jokes in class, so you know, you have to. I used to work on ships, so I learned, I don't curse in class, but you're doing a ship, but I do. And I say three words, ask your mother. And they would look, and what I mean by that is look at affirmative action and the rights that did in establishing the role of women to go beyond the glass ceilings. And all these came out of the struggles of early whites to fight for the rights of blacks, but also centered on the role of people like Benezé. You must remember that the first organization, the Free African Association, was founded under the auspices of Benezé, and that Du Bois said was the beginning of black organizations and the real reason that the NAACP was later on formed. Mm-hmm. So let's go back to you then. Now you are looking at a work on Robert Kennedy. Mm-hmm. And of course, many African Americans have many mixed feelings about Robert Kennedy. So why don't you tell us a little bit about that?
I have a lot of questions about Robert Kennedy, but I think, you know, I've looked at sort of civil rights struggles broadly framed through the 20th century. And to me, it is remarkable when people can actually see it, because so much is taken for granted. I mean, right now, we're living with all these questions around police violence and what that reveals about what's happening in our cities and the kinds of gaps in education and healthcare and jobs and all the rest. And Kennedy is a person, you know, you get a different look on the 60s because he is someone. I mean, I just spoke with John Lewis yesterday, who was changed by the movement, as Attorney General, he was exposed to certain realities in this country and had to deal with them. And began to see things that he didn't understand. And I think what's particularly interesting when I think about, again, the NAACP founded in response to the Northern problem as people migrate in this really dynamic landscape of race in this country and racial geography, his concern was drawn to what was happening in Northern cities to young people. And after his brother's assassination and a senator, he really paid attention to that. And in response to the Watts riot, and back to Du Bois's point about the Negro problem, what shall we do about the Negro problem, he gave a speech in upstate New York. It was right after the passing of the Voting Rights Act, which John Doerr has said that Robert Kennedy was the person most responsible in terms of national leadership. But he didn't want to talk about that. He wanted to talk about Watts. And he wanted to talk about, he said, not a Negro problem, but an American problem, right? And I think being able to frame it that way, it's almost going back to Walling and to those founders of the NAACP. What does this mean for our democracy? What does this mean for our society? And he talked about history. I mean, I think the role of history in illuminating this current moment is so important, and it doesn't, you know, it's not brought to bear in how we see the challenges today. I mean, what are your thoughts on that as a scholar, a former activist or a continuing activist, and a teacher?
Well, one tempers reality with hope. Hope, I was looking at the events around Baltimore, and I saw all the violence. But something happened, I saw, as I watched the TV, and no one talked about it. And that was, at one meeting, there were young white women. And young white women, many with little kids and pregnant. And they were there marching with these blacks. And when I saw that, I thought that maybe we're onto something. Maybe if such things happen nationwide, if young whites join in with young blacks at these things, maybe the nation can be saved.
Good note to end on.
Good morning.
Morning.
I'm assuming you can figure out who's Pauline and who's Jeff up here. If not, I think I saw an optician store a couple blocks away on Independence Avenue. It's a real pleasure to be here. It's a pleasure especially to meet Jeff, whom I did not have the pleasure, did not know until yesterday. I certainly know his professors quite well and his colleagues, and I think the project he's working on is really fascinating. We've heard already, we started with a discussion of walking around in tombs, and I think the second panel talked raised issues of morality, but now we have a project which brings the two together. Jeff gave a talk on his project, which was called Moral Depth in a Chinese Tomb. And he's working on an 11th century figure and his family tombs. It turns out that the person he's working on was could in fact be called the perhaps China's first archaeologist. And I'd really like to hear more about that, but I'm interested in specifically the moral issues that are raised in this by this tomb excavation, by this person you're studying, and I think more generally the kinds of, say, ethical responsibilities that you see we as scholars have with respect to dealing with the objects that we study and the lives that we reconstruct thanks to those objects. So morality in a number of different spheres.
Thank you very much. That's a very deep and extended question. And I think I want to thank the Kluge Center for giving me the opportunity to be here. I think that I could go on for hours talking about this site and the people who are buried in it, but I think for because of the time, I'll focus on the issue of the moral questions that you raised. The place that I'm working on, you can't go there, you can't look at the material and not be self-reflexive. It demands it of you for precisely the reason that the key figure buried in this tomb was himself a scholar who was engaged in the study of the material remains of his past, that he and the scholars he was affiliated with were actively engaged in purchasing in urban markets from tomb robbers. And so, insofar as the site itself was discovered in 2006 by tomb robbers, and then local archaeologists moved in and surveyed the site, one would have to be something of a dolt to not be reflective on what that means for us today. One of the things that's been key for me, and here I'll turn the question around in a moment, is the way in which engaging that material has led me to question broader paradigms of how archaeologists deal with their subjects, and whether we shouldn't, at some level, allow the specifics of the materials that we're looking at to reframe the broader methodologies, theories, approaches that we bring to bear, to, if you will, allow these objects to have a kind of catalyzing force on our own minds and our own frameworks of analysis. And the reason I'll turn this around is because you sort of started your career doing very in-depth studies and translations of early Chinese poetry, classical Chinese poetry primarily from the Tang Dynasty and so forth, most famously the work of the famous 8th century poet Wang Wei. And in that work, I remember the introduction to that book, which we of course all had to read, was you said that the role of the translator was to strike a balance between fidelity and felicity. And when you think about your more recent work, you've turned in more recent years to looking at the way early Chinese poetry was translated, or early Chinese poetry, classical Chinese poetry was translated in the 19th century and in the early 20th century, the first translations into European languages. And I think for certainly people who are among my teachers would feel that many of those early translations erred on the side of felicity rather than fidelity. But in your work, you have written about them in a more sympathetic light. And so I wonder if in that balance between a sort of rigorous responsibility to the historical subject who wrote the poem and a sense that we still have to make this live in the present, if we aren't actually grappling with similar issues of our moral responsibility to the past.
I think that's a great question. Thank you for remembering something that I wrote that I'm sure I have long since forgotten. So, interesting. I have in recent years come back to a project that was first suggested to me when I was in graduate school over 30 years ago. And I had completely forgotten about it because I wasn't interested in doing anything about it. I was a graduate student in comparative literature. And the last thing that anybody in comparative literature in the 1970s was going to do was to compare, because comparative literature was about theory, and what you wanted to do was to use the theory to understand something about literature, perhaps, but had very little to do with comparison of works between in different languages. And it just happened that as I was unpacking the last of boxes that I had moved my effects into New York about 10 years ago, I came across a folder from graduate school with a slip of paper on it that said, look into the work of Judith Gautier, because you have all the languages. She wrote in French, she translated into Chinese, and then her work was picked up by German poets and also used, among other things, as the song texts for Mahler's Song of the Earth. And you do German too. But that was just such a traditional comparative project. And it was also, in the eyes of my, sinological advisors, a pointless one. Because as you said, she didn't really know Chinese that well. And why would you bother to spend the time on it? Well, I decided that this might actually be something worth looking into. And of course, I think a lot of part of the reason two reasons. One is that I've become very interested in the history of knowledge and sort of knowledge production. And her translations were the first literary translations into a European language. And they were hugely influential. They were retranslated into almost every other European language. And second, I think the notion of fidelity has become an expanded one. I mean, the notion of what a good what role translation can play, let's say, has become expanded. And that there are translations that domesticate a foreign text in a way that provides perhaps greater access to that text than one that is, strictly speaking, a truly faithful one. So I've spent the last few years actually going through her translations, discovering that many of them were pretty close to the Chinese, and so in that sense could be called faithful, but that in many others provided other kinds of a vantage point into how Chinese poetry works, even if they were not faithful, and that overall her whole project had an enormous influence on French, contemporary French poetry. So it's just, I think it's a more mature way of looking at a project that I initially discarded as being completely useless.
Sure.
We've used up our 9 minutes.
We have one more minute. So can I ask one last question, follow up on that? Would you like to take the floor?
Well, you can ask one, and I'll ask one really quickly.
All right, we'll be quick. So just to follow up on that, we've heard a lot of discussion today about the relevance of various historical moments to the present, be it the race relations in the United States, the Cold War, the history of the Civil War, and so forth. And 8th century Chinese poetry doesn't typically leap onto the front page when people think about relevance to our current condition. And yet I feel that there's a germ of an answer to why it is relevant in what you just said, and I wonder if you might, for the sake of the humanities and what we do, say something.
Well, that would have been my question, too. I think that one of the things that's important to know about the 8th century in China is that one had to write Chinese poetry in order to become a Chinese bureaucrat and to become someone who would actually play an important role in Chinese politics and society. Poetry was something that was considered useful and an index of your intelligence and your ability to do something publicly. And I think this is something China remembered for a long time, and then it forgot about it. And I'm hoping that your experience in China recently suggests that a new esteem for the humanities is...
Yeah, absolutely. I think there's, you see the developments of liberal arts curricula across Chinese universities now, a big surge of it, really in the last 5 years. And so things are changing. And I think that there is a new space for this kind of material and the sort of work that we do in reinforming public discourse there, and hopefully here as well.
Thank you.
Please join me in thanking all of our speakers. Our hope was that today you got not only a cornucopia of ideas, but also a sampling of the outstanding scholars that we have had at the Kluge Center over the past 15 years, and perhaps a foreshadowing of the future outstanding scholars that we will have at the Kluge Center for the next 15 years and beyond. I promised you a few moments for questions. We are running close to 10:30, but there are index cards that hopefully some of you have taken or you've made notes in your programs. I think the way to handle this, because of the time, is I'm going to ask three people, if you raise your hands, I'll call on three people to ask their very short, concise questions. We'll do three in a row, and then I will leave it to the panel of scholars here to choose which ones that they will address in the limited time that we have. So if you have any questions, short, concise questions, please raise your hand now, or a reflective statement that you'd like to offer. We can take hands, and I see one hand over here. Wow, and a couple hands over here. Okay, so we'll ask that question there, and then Sonia will ask her question, and then we'll leave it to the scholars to answer.
Okay, this is a question for Hitchcock and Keller. I'd like to hear one specific impact of the Cold War on America now, or on one country from Latin America now. One concrete, specific, ongoing effect that we can see of the Cold War.
Okay, great. And then we'll take Sonia's question, unless it's the same question.
I have a question for Renata as well. You mentioned that the Cold War impacted the current war on drugs, and I'd love for you to expand on that. A lot of US historians who look at mass incarceration and the war on drugs look at it within our own domestic sphere, and I feel like discussions about Latin America get left out a lot, and yet you're right, it is a global war that we're fighting. So if you could just expand on that point that you made.
Okay, great. So I'll ask Will to stand and address the first question and Renata to stand and address the second question.
The warfare state. I don't know where that question came from, but it may not be specific enough for you. But we live in the warfare state that was invented as early as 1946, maybe as late as 1950, certainly re-enhanced in 1953. After the end of the Korean War, when the United States was no longer in active hostilities, we increased the amount of defense spending, and it has never been ratcheted back ever since. There's been total continuity from the early Cold War to the present. We live in an environment that has been warped by our belief that we have to constantly be preparing for the next war, and that becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy, in my view. Thank you.
Thanks for your question. So in terms of the Cold War and the war on drugs, and I'm actually just teaching a class on that, so I'm excited to talk about it. But, one example is that, so a lot of the defense organizations that I've been studying, the intelligence organizations that were funded in order to keep track of, you know, internal local subversives, then later became corrupt and became involved in drug trafficking. And so the people who were supposed to be protecting the nation ended up creating the very danger that now is a much larger and much more serious threat than communism really ever was in Latin America. So the same people who were supposed to be keeping the communists out were the ones that became involved in drug trafficking when it became such a problem in the beginning of the 60s, the 70s, and the 80s, and especially in Mexico or places like Colombia as well.
That was so efficient. We actually have time for one more. If there are any last questions, one in the back there, sure.
Yes, hello. I had a question for Arana and Hidalgo. My question is about, you spoke a little bit about writing history for broader audiences, and I'm often struck by the fact that history that becomes popular is often written in a certain genre, you know, with military history and biography come to mind. And so I wonder if it is certain genres of history that can be popularized, perhaps because they lend themselves well to narrative, while other kinds of historical research are a lot more difficult to do that with. So the question is about genre.
Great, and I'll ask Marie and Alex to both stand and address that.
That's a really good question. I think that history, as we all know, is a mess, and it's not organized at all. It's not neat, it's not tidy, it's not digestible, really. And what popular historians do, or people who write history in that digestible fashion, need to impose a sort of narrative arc. A narrative arc, as we all know, is elusive and illusionary in a way, because it doesn't actually reflect the truth that is going that was going on at the time. And I think it's so important to remember that the historians who really do this well, who really do that narrative arc well, are always knitting back context. And I think that is so important. And if you really look at the ones that are successful in doing that narrative story well, you will see that knitting all the time, all the way through, because you can't really tell history in a tidy way without spinning a million plates in the process. Alex?
I have no idea how to respond to that question. I haven't figured it out. I'm barely trying. I think for me as an academic, I want to try to tell a compelling story about the individuals that I find in my documents, and I want to embed that within a nice theoretical framework, hopefully something that's fairly digestible. The one thing that I do have to say, and I'll add that, so you mentioned military history and biographies and so forth, I've noticed in my very short career that maps also fall into that realm. People seem to be incredibly attracted to them, so I'm going to exploit that as much as possible.
That's a great note to end on.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.